Good afternoon and welcome once more to COVID National Combined Grand Rounds, which we are holding jointly from the All Institute of Medical Sciences and from NITI Aayog. In this series, based on a lot of feedback that we got, this time we are discussing COVID-19 in pregnancy and in the neonate. Now, pregnancy itself shows a lot of challenges when it comes to managing pregnant women who are positive as far as COVID-19 is concerned, both in terms of infection control practices and in terms of the management strategies that one has to adopt. Also, there are other issues which come up with the neonate in terms of should they be tested, should they be isolated, what are the do's and don'ts. And I think this is something which has been an area where a lot of people have uncertainty. To resolve all of these uncertainties, we are having this grand round today, and we have a very esteemed panel with us who will answer your questions and try and resolve these issues. I have on my left Professor Sunesh Kumar, who is Professor and Head of Obstetrics and Gynae at the All Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi. The other panelist is Professor A.K. Diwari, he is Professor and Head of Pediatrics at the All Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi. We also have Professor Nirja Bhatla, Professor of Obstetrics and Gynae at All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. Joining us through Skype is Dr. Praveen Kumar, Head of Neonatology at PGI Chandigarh. And it's great to have Dr. Kumar on board for this COVID grand round. We also have Dr. Neena Raina. And Dr. Neena Raina is a Senior Advisor for Reproductive, Maternal and Newborn Child and Adolescent Health and Aging at the World Health Organization Regional Office for Southeast Asia. Welcome, Dr. Neena Raina. We also have Dr. Manju Puri. She is Professor and Head of Obstetrics and Gynae at Lady Harding Medical College, New Delhi. Thank you very much for joining us. And then we have Dr. Arpana Sharma, who is an Associate Professor of Obstetrics and Gynae at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. So what we will do is we will have two case presentations highlighting the challenges that we had in managing cases with COVID-19 and pregnancy and neonatal management. Also trying to show the challenges that one has, we'll in our discussion discuss both managing normal pregnancy and pregnancy, what we would call high risk pregnancy as far as COVID-19 is concerned. And then we'll have a presentation on the neonate with COVID-19. So we'll start off with the case presentation, after which I'll just ask the panelists for a few comments, and then we will have a case discussion, a discussion of a topic, after which we will then have a question and answer session. So, Dr. Nilufer Noor, Senior Resident Obstetrics and Gynae, will be presenting the first case, and this is pregnant women with COVID-19. So I'll ask her to present the case, and after that we will take it forward. Dr. Noor, please.
Thank you very much, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. Our patient was a 20-year-old third gravida previous to abortion, known case of Takayasu arthritis and chronic hypertension on oral labetalol 300 mg TDS. She presented to our labor ward triage area at 33 weeks and 2 days with pain abdomen. Our labor ward triage area is a designated area outside the labor ward where the patients are screened for COVID symptoms using a screen form where there are symptoms of COVID-19 infection, any travel history, contact history, and residence in hotspot. And based on this, if they screen negative and require admission, they're admitted in the holding area where they're kept until the COVID report is available. And based on the COVID report, they're shifted to clean labor ward or a designated COVID facility. If they're screened positive, they're considered as COVID suspect and they're admitted in suspect area, and again a COVID test is done, and based on the report, they're further managed. Our patient was screened negative and therefore was admitted in the holding area and a COVID sample was sent. Meanwhile, while a COVID report was awaited, further history, examination and management was continued. She was booked at AIIMS at 9 weeks and diagnosed with Takayasu arthritis during workup of chronic hypertension. Cardiology and rheumatology consultations were sought during her antenatal visits, and she was started on oral aspirin 150 mg OD, oral prednisolone 7.5 mg OD, and oral labetalol, which was titrated as per her blood pressure records. To begin with, she was started on 100 mg TDS, which was increased to 300 mg TDS at the time of presentation to labor ward triage area. However, 3 months back, she stopped prednisolone due to lockdown. She has history of previous 2 spontaneous abortions at 1.5 months and 2 months of gestation, and she was diagnosed with chronic hypertension 2 months prior to conception and started on oral methyl dopa 500 milligrams TDS in a private setup. On examination, her general condition was fair. However, her blood pressure was raised in the range of 160 by 110 millimeters of mercury and remained in this range after 15 minutes when repeated, and therefore an impression of superimposed preeclampsia was made. Other chest and CVS examination was normal. Per abdominal examination, the uterus was 32 weeks and mild contractions were present. The fetal heart rate could be heard. On per speculum examination, the os was closed. Thereby, a diagnosis of threatened preterm labor was made. Her investigations related to Takayasu arthritis were reviewed. MRI had shown right common carotid and right renal artery stenosis. Echo showed mild MR with ejection fraction of 50%. Ultrasound KB was normal. For preeclampsia, on admission, a urine dipstick was done, which was 1+. Her PIH parameters such as CBC, LFT and KFT were done and were found to be normal. Fundus examination was also normal. For fetal surveillance, a Manning score was done, which was 8x8 at admission. And a growth scan showed an estimated fetal weight of 1755 grams, an amniotic fluid index of 3 to 4 centimeters, but the umbilical artery Doppler showed absent end-diastolic flow, and therefore an impression of fetus with AADF was made. While awaiting the COVID report, she was managed for preeclampsia. For control of blood pressure, injection labetalol 20 milligrams IV was given, and blood pressure was monitored every 15 minutes for 1 hour and then half hourly. Following this, the blood pressure remained stabilized and she did not require further labetalol injections. For fetal surveillance, a cardiography was done and Manning score was done and were both normal. For threatened preterm labor, the NICU team was informed and antenatal steroids for fetal lung maturity were initiated. Also, nifedipine tocolysis was initiated. Following this, the contractions ceased and after about 1 hour later, the uterus was relaxed. And therefore, a decision was made to continue the pregnancy to allow steroid cover as now the blood pressure was controlled and the uterus was also relaxed. Meanwhile, monitoring was also continued. After about 2 hours following the sampling, her COVID report was available and was found to be positive for COVID-19. And therefore, she was shifted to a designated COVID facility, that is Trauma Center AIMS. During transfer to COVID facility, the nodal officer was informed and COVID facility was informed so that they could prepare to receive the patient. And from the holding area, the patient was transferred via designated pathway to via COVID corridor and lift, and via a COVID ambulance. She was sent to the COVID facility where she was received. So the story so far is that she presented to us at about 5 p.m. in the labor room triage area where she was screened negative based on history, and then she was admitted to the holding area where her COVID sample was sent and further management was continued. During this time, she was managed for preeclampsia with antihypertensives and BP was monitored, and for threatened preterm labor, steroids were started, tocolysis was given and contractions were monitored. For absent end-diastolic flow, Manning and cardiography was done. By about 7:30 p.m., her COVID report was available and the COVID facility was intimated to make bed arrangements, and she was transferred to COVID facility via dedicated COVID corridor, COVID lift and COVID ambulance. And by about 8:30 p.m., she was received in COVID facility and further management was continued by various specialties in COVID team. The hospital course in COVID facility, an infectious disease specialist and the NICU team were consulted regarding antenatal steroids as there was a concern that steroids may worsen maternal outcome. However, since this patient was asymptomatic, it was decided to continue the steroid therapy for fetal lung maturity. Maternal and fetal monitoring was continued. Mother was monitored for symptoms and signs of COVID, and her blood pressure was monitored and was controlled on oral labetalol 300 milligrams TDS. The uterus remained relaxed and tocolysis was tapered. Steroid cover was completed. For the fetus, daily non-stress test was done, daily Manning score was done, and daily fetal umbilical artery Doppler and Leica were done. Also, maternal perception of fetal movements were noted. At 33 weeks and 4 days of gestation, that is day 3 of transfer to COVID ward, once the last dose of steroid was given, Manning score was repeated and was found to be 4x8, that is only tone and single Leica pocket were found, but gross body movements and breathing were not found. And therefore, she was planned for emergency LSCS in view of absent end-diastolic flow with poor Manning score. Anesthetists were informed. In view of history of prednisolone intake and abrupt stoppage, endocrinology review was sought, and it was decided to give injection hydrocortisone for recovery of HPA axis during intra and immediate post-operative period. She received injection hydrocortisone 100 mg at the time of anesthesia, followed by 10 mg per hour infusion for 6 hours. The cesarean section was done with minimal number of persons in the OT and healthcare team was in PPE. Regional anesthesia was given and antibiotic prophylaxis was given. Nicotine was present in the OT and she delivered a female baby of 1640 grams with an Apgar score of 7/9. In the post-operative period, oral labetalol 3 mg TDS was continued, but the blood pressure remained in the range of 160 to 170 mm mercury systolic and 90 to 70 mm mercury diastolic, and therefore oral amlodipine 10 mg OD was added. This also did not result in stabilizing the BP, and therefore cardiology review was sought. Oral enalapril 2.5 mg BD was added. Following this, the blood pressure was controlled. Adequate hydration and early ambulation was ensured. A rheumatology review was sought in view of her Takayasu arthritis, but since the disease was not found to be in active stage, further prednisolone was not continued. Patient remained asymptomatic for COVID infection, and a repeat COVID test after 14 days was found to be negative, after which she was shifted to non-COVID ward as baby was in nursery. The baby was initially under NICU care in COVID facility and developed sepsis, but the baby recovered and was found to be COVID negative, tested on day 5 of life as per protocol, and then repeat on day 14 before shifting her to non-COVID nursery. Currently, the baby was on room air, oral gastric feeds, and express breast milk. To summarize, a 20-year-old third gravida previous to abortion at 33 weeks and 2 days period gestation, known case of Takayasu arthritis and chronic hypertension with superimposed preeclampsia and asymptomatic COVID-19 infection, and fetus with absent end diastolic flow presented to us in preterm preterm labor and underwent an emergency NSCS at 33 weeks and 4 days of gestation in view of absent end diastolic flow and poor manning, and delivered a female baby of 1640 grams requiring NICU care but was negative for COVID and is currently on express breastfeeds. The patient had a good post-operative recovery and is currently blood pressure is controlled and triple antihypertensives. Both the mother and the baby have been shifted to the non-COVID ward after 14 days. Our patient had a multidisciplinary approach, received a multidisciplinary approach throughout her antenatal, intrapartum and postpartum period, and the team involved obstetrician, cardiologist, rheumatologist, neonatologist, anesthetist, endocrinologist and infectious disease specialist. And this approach was the key to having a favorable maternal and fetal outcome in our patient. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think this was a very comprehensive presentation of a complicated case, Takayasu with other complications, preeclampsia, that was managed successfully by the team, and it was a multidisciplinary team which actually was involved in looking after these cases. So before we go to the neonatal part, just one or two questions to Dr. Sunish. First of all, the challenges that you face, especially in terms of suspected patients or positive patients, pregnant women who are coming now to our institute in this era of COVID-19.
In our hospital, we tend to book patients who have some underlying complication. Often it is cardiac problems. There may be patient with severe preeclampsia, antepartum hemorrhage, twin pregnancy. So most of our patients have some obstetric or medical complication. This was one of the patients who had pre-diagnosed a cardiac problem, a Takayasu arthritis, and she was being managed for that. We had other patients in last 6 months of this COVID pandemic which is with us, and there have been patients with serious complications, cardiac failure due to underlying heart disease, and other patients, eclampsia patients, severe preeclampsia. So depending upon her condition, they are managed by a multidisciplinary approach. And this case which Dr. Nilofar just presented highlighted how in our hospital a multidisciplinary approach, most departments are easily approachable and they help us in managing this case. Thanks, sir.
Thank you. Would you like to add something to that?
Thank you, sir. Actually, I think Dr. Sunesha summarized it really very nicely. But I would just say that we are facing problems because of the discontinuity of care which has happened in the case of many pregnancies. Like this patient who was actually our booked patient and yet she stopped taking the medicine on her own. And then suddenly they present to you in an emergency situation. So as sir said, we are very fortunate that we have a lot of colleagues who are ready to come in and help us at all hours. And we could have a successful outcome. But it's very important for women around the country to realize that they cannot stop medications without asking their doctors. And it's so important for them to see that they keep meeting them and taking the treatment.
Thank you very much. I think the challenge is, of course, because of COVID-19, the fear that is there, the stigma and the reluctance to come to hospital, a lot of routine care, especially antenatal care, has actually suffered a lot, and this is having an effect, as has been mentioned, both in terms of outcomes and in terms of morbidity. So we will discuss this in detail after the case presentation, after the topic discussion. We go on to the next case, which is neonate with COVID-19, and this is by the Department of Pediatrics, and Dr. Ankit Verma, assistant professor in the Department of Pediatrics, will be presenting these interesting cases. Over to you, Dr. Verma.
Thank you, sir. So, I shall be discussing the neonates with COVID-19 infection and shall be summarizing the key messages with supporting evidences. Our first newborn was a term baby, born LFT, born to a primary gravida mother with uneventful antenatal period. Mother was on tablet olanzapine for psychosis. She had spontaneous onset of labor and delivered vaginally. Baby cried immediately after birth. Delayed cord clamping and skin-to-skin contact was done for the baby. The baby was shifted to the mother's side and we did the random blood sugar and hematocrit monitoring for initial 48 hours, which came out to be normal. We established the direct breastfeeding on demand. Cord TSH level was sent for the baby, which came out to be normal. The baby was vaccinated on day 1 of life and was given BCG, OPV and hepatitis B vaccine. Mother, in the postnatal ward on day 2, had developed fever. She was tested for novel coronavirus and which came out to be positive. The baby was subsequently tested for novel coronavirus which came out to be positive on day 5. The baby was observed for total 10 days and was discharged on 10th day after being remaining asymptomatic. Our second neonate was again a term baby, who was born to a primary gravida mother with uneventful antenatal period. This mother was positive for novel coronavirus. A cesarean section was taken for the mother in view of fetal distress. The baby was delivered as a MSL baby, which was a vigorous baby. Baby cried immediately after birth. We did the delayed cord clamping of the baby and the baby was subsequently shifted to mother's side, where we had established the direct breastfeeding on demand for the baby. On day 2 of life, vaccination was done. Baby had developed jaundice requiring phototherapy for 12 hours on day 2 of life and was tested for novel coronavirus which came out to be positive on day 5 of life. The baby was observed for total 9 days and had remained asymptomatic and was planned discharged. Now coming to the patient pathways which is being followed in our hospital, the mother with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 infection is taken care in the isolation facility, where we are having separate entry and exit doors for the patients and separate donning and doffing areas for the healthcare provider. The delivery is planned by that of the obstetrician and an ICU team is informed. The principle of resuscitation, they remain same despite the mode of delivery. Coming to the transport, after stabilization at the birth, baby, if stable, is shifted to mother's side. If the baby is sick, the neonate is transferred using the same resuscitation warmer to the neonatal isolation facility by the resuscitation team, which also remains the same during the time of transport. We use a dedicated COVID doorway for the transport of the baby. Once a stable baby's room is there with that of the mother, the baby is roomed in in the mother's isolation room, where the baby is taken care of by that of the nurse, mother, and affected family member. If the mother is tested negative, we stop the isolation and shift the mother-baby diet to the maternity ward. If mother is tested positive, we continue the isolation of the mother-baby diet. In case of a sick neonate who is there in the neonatal isolation facility, the baby is taken care by that of the neonatal team member wearing proper PPE. If mother is tested negative, we stop the isolation and shift the baby to the routine NICU. If mother is tested positive, we continue the neonatal care in the same isolation facility and shift to another isolation facility if neonate is tested positive. Coming to the evidence related with that of the breastfeeding and COVID-19 infection, Salvatore et al. Had found that 120 neonates born to 116 COVID-positive mother who were roomed in and breastfed, they were none of them had been tested positive on day 1, day 5 and day 14 of life. Fox et al. Had found that secretory immunoglobulin, IgA, immune response against that of the COVID-19 virus was found in 12 out of the 15 breast milk samples in the mothers who were COVID positive. WHO recommends that suspected or confirmed COVID-19 mother, they should initiate or continue breastfeeding. So, breastfeeding is considered to be safe. These are the guidelines issued by that of the WHO for ensuring safe breastfeeding practices. Mother, she should have frequent hand hygiene, and the frequent hand hygiene should be done before and after breastfeeding and touching the baby. Mother should wear a mask while breastfeeding and providing care to the baby. Routinely clean and disinfection of the surfaces needs to be done. In case of a sick baby where expression of milk is required, it should be collected and transported very carefully to avoid any contamination. Now coming to the evidence related with that of the place of caring of COVID-positive mother-baby diet, Salvatore et al. Had found that 83% of the neonates who were roomed in with that of the COVID-positive mother, none of them had tested positive at day 1, day 5 and day 14 of life. WHO, RCOG, NNF, POCSI, IAP, all of them, they recommend that mother and infant should be enabled to remain together while rooming in throughout the day and night and to practice skin-to-skin contact, including the kangaroo mother care. So, baby mother diet can be kept together in isolation facility. Now, coming to the vertical transmission in COVID-19 infection. The vertical transmission, as defined by that of the Blumber et al., is set when the mother is COVID positive for coronavirus between the 14 days prior to that of the birth and 2 days after the birth. And the virus is detected in any of the following, that is, in the swab of neonatal respiratory tract, or in the amniotic fluid, or in the umbilical cord blood, or a neonatal blood sample in the first 24 hours of the life. Now, this is the evidence where Liu et al., London et al., and Yang et al. Had found that babies born to COVID-positive mother who were tested, all of them were tested negative. However, Farazi et al. Had found that only 3 out of the 42 neonates, they were found to be positive. So, vertical transmission is very rare. Coming to the testing at the time of birth, CDC recommends that both symptomatic and asymptomatic neonates born to COVID positive or confirmed mother, they should have testing performed at approximately 24 hours of the age. It further says that in resource constrained settings, we should prioritize testing for neonates with signs suggestive of COVID-19 and coronavirus exposure requiring higher level of care or who are expected to have prolonged hospitalization, that is more than 48 hours. So, testing to be done at birth only and only if baby and mother are going to be separated, that is in case of a sick or in case of a LBW baby. Now, coming to the care in the isolation room, the symptomatic or sick neonate born to a suspected or COVID-positive mother, they need to be managed in the isolation facility. If it is not available or if multiple COVID-exposed infant, they must be cohorted. There should be at least 6 feet difference between that of the infants. The negative airborne isolation rooms are preferred for preventing aerosol transmission. The isolation room should have adequate ventilation and minimum 12 air changes per hour should be there. The staff which is handling to these babies, it should be separate and we should
be adhering to that of the local recommended PPE guidelines. That is, the staff should be wearing a triple layer surgical mask or N95 face mask, goggles or face shield, full sleeve, water resistant gown, and well fitting gloves. Now coming to the testing strategy, the RT-PCR is considered to be the gold standard for testing the neonates. The CDC, it recommends that for asymptomatic neonate expected to be discharged within first 48 hours of the age, a single test can be performed prior to that of the discharge between 24 to 48 hours of the age. The ICMR guideline says that asymptomatic direct and high risk contact of a confirmed case needs to be tested once between day 5 and day 10 of coming into contact. NNF, FOXI, IFE, it recommends that if first test is negative, a repeat test should be done after 5 to 14 days of birth or exposure. So, RT-PCR remains the gold standard and testing needs to be done at day 5 or at the time of discharge. Coming to the some of the key messages, breast milk is considered to be safe. The viral load in the breast milk is very low. Rather, it is consisting of the serum IgA level. It is consisting of the secretory IgA as well as IgG antibodies, which are protective for prevention of the novel coronavirus in the neonate. The mother and the baby, they can be kept together, provided mother, she takes proper respiratory hygiene, that is wears a face mask and also observes a proper hand hygiene. The isolation ward is warranted for the sick or LBW baby or in case where the mother is sick. And here the care is provided by that of the healthcare provider using proper PPE. The vertical transmission in neonate is very rare and testing in initial 48 hours needs to be done only in the research mode for the generation of evidence. The testing may be done for stable neonates on day 5 or prior to that of the discharge in the babies born to COVID positive mother so that they do not infect the family members, especially the grandparents at the home. Or it needs to be done whenever symptomatic the baby become with the symptoms of influenza like illness or that of the SARS. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ankit Verma, for a very comprehensive presentation. Before we go to the talk on pregnancy with COVID-19, just a few questions regarding the two cases that were presented to Dr. Dirari. One was, in the case that was presented to obstetrics and gynae, a repeat testing was done on day 14, after the first test being done initially. Do we need to do that? Is it mandatory that we should retest once the neonate is being discharged? And in your experience, how common is vertical transmission? This is one of the questions that has already come in. That what is the AIIMS experience as far as vertical transmission? It's already been shown that it's not common or uncommon. Do we have any experience?
Well, thank you, sir, for the two questions. As far as vertical transmission goes, sir, there are only occasional case reports which are there. And there are some criteria which have to be fulfilled why you say it is vertical transmission. Looking at what is existing in the literature, I would say at this point of time, at the time of birth, if the mother is positive, there is no point in doing COVID RT-PCR at the time of birth because the risk for vertical transmission is minuscule. If someone has to do it, it has to be done in a research mode, as Ankit is saying. And then to fulfill that it is vertical transmission, we have to show that either the virus is there in the placenta or in the amniotic fluid. And then in the birth, at the time of birth also, the baby has the RT-PCR, which is positive. Or you have to show even the antibodies which will be transferred to the baby. So these criteria have to be fulfilled. So I would say at this point, sir, there is no point in doing at the time of birth to look for, and we should not get worried about vertical transmission. It should be done in the research mode and ICMR should support such type of research. Your second question was that in this baby, we did second test before shifting the baby. So this baby was, which is presented by obstetrics department, was born low birth weight. was in trauma center. Trauma center is with lot of adult patients who are COVID positive. The child was cared in the ICU with the adult patients who have high viral load. And the baby was stable and we had to shift the mother. And then our team, before we took the baby to the NICU, wanted to be very, very sure that the baby is negative. So we did the test. If the baby would have been going home, we would have discharged the baby without doing the second test. I hope.
Yes. So I think that we just, I was just trying to emphasize that point only, that because the baby was coming back into the main hospital, it was just to be sure both from the healthcare protection point of view and otherwise. And that's why when the baby was being shifted out from the COVID facility to a non-COVID facility, the test was done. But otherwise, it is not something which one would routinely have done if the baby was being discharged. So I think, thank you for highlighting those two points, because I didn't want a wrong message to go up that each time at the time of discharge, you have to start testing again the newborn. So we'll, before we take all the questions, and there are a number of questions which have come to WhatsApp, and I would remind the audience to send their questions to WhatsApp on the mobile that is coming at the bottom. The number is 9999692364. I'll repeat that. 9999692364. Please send your questions relating to today's topic, and the experts will try and answer your questions, and we'll try and cover most of the questions, hopefully all of them. Now we'll go forward to the talk, which is managing pregnancy with COVID-19. And Dr. Arpana Sharma, who is a faculty in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, will be covering this topic. So over to you, Dr. Sharma.
Respected Director Sir and esteemed panelists, my colleagues and dear friends. So although we started with a case which was very, very complicated and with a lot of comorbidities, what we are going to do now is discuss the very basics of managing pregnancy with COVID-19. And we will discuss this in three parts: facility preparedness, antenatal care, labor and delivery. Facility preparedness, we would like to discuss, and whether it's a small facility or it's a big hospital, everything can be actually put into just five aspects. One is SOP, standard operating procedure. Second is infrastructure. Third is PPE. Fourth is personnel. And fifth is infection control practices. If we remember these five things, we are ready for COVID. So we started as a facility, as an institute, we started in March when we first established a task force to understand the resources which are needed, find the solutions to challenges and resolve the crisis. So it's a day-to-day activity which is required and complete involvement of the people who are there. So talking about the first aspect, so every facility who is dealing with COVID patients should have a written SOP and understanding about what we define as a suspect, how the patient who's a suspect will come in, what is the area management, what is the human resource management. So it should have a written document with a dated document, because it is going to evolve as our definitions change in the COVID pandemic. So for example, we have a workflow for AIMS defined. So if a suspect comes and she needs a cesarean, the cesarean will be done in suspect OT, and she would be delivered in the suspect OT. If she's either, and after admission, her test will be sent. And depending on her test, if she tests positive, she will be shifted to the designated positive center, which is a trauma center. And if she's negative, she goes to the ward. Now, the second aspect of the facility preparedness is infrastructure. When we say infrastructure, it doesn't have to be a separate building or a place that we need to, you know, create. It is just reorganization. So we need to have a screening and a triage area, which was shown in the case when we presented the case. If the lady is screened negative, she goes to a normal labor room. If she's a suspect, she goes to the suspect facility. And she's positive, she goes to the designated positive facility. So we need to have an idea of setting up the screening and the triage area and the suspect and the positive facility, which is essentially the basic, more or less the same. So we can see here a triage area where all we need is a simple barricading of that area with personnel sitting in the proper required PP. And the women who are coming in should be advised proper distancing. And in a busy area, what we really need is a good crowd control in a well-ventilated, spacious area.
Also, it is not just the patient who needs to be screened. The healthcare personnel need to be screened. So we have something like a register where every day whoever is coming in is screened for symptoms. For patients, we have a screening questionnaire. Also, attendants are supposed to be kept at minimum. Most importantly, when we develop a suspect facility, we need to try and have a unidirectional flow of movement from the donning area, a patient corridor which is tried to be kept separate, the donning and the doffing area which is at the end of the suspect area. The OT and the labor delivery areas are in the middle and the exit is towards the end. So ideal suspect or a positive facility would be one where there is a unidirectional movement of people right from the entry to the exit. This is the example of a suspect area that we created in a previously existing OPD area which was converted to a suspect area with the donning area path towards the COVID area, a path beyond which the entry was only in PPE and a corridor for bringing in the COVID positive mother from a separate corridor and designated lifts for COVID positive patients so that there is no intermingling of patients. Most importantly, there have been lots of issues about the air conditioning. It's nice to have a different place where you can have a different air conditioning system separately. But if that is not available, then a simple good ventilation with stand-alone air conditioner with more than 12 changes per hour is good. Even if that is not available, just 3 to 4 exhaust fans with a minimum distance of 1 meter between adjacent beds is good enough for a suspect area. Now coming to the personal protective equipment, most importantly, it should be available, there should be rational use, there should be visual aids for wearing the PPE, and there should be a continuous supply chain. At the triage points, the minimum PPE is a N95 mask with gloves. In a non-COVID labor room where the patient has come and she has been screened, a minimum is a gloves with a mask with a gown and a face shield in the labor room we wear because patients are usually in second stage, they are expiring very, very heavily. So we advise a face shield. In a suspect or a positive, it is always better to have a level 2 PPE, which is a coverall. In addition to that, always wear waterproof apron and Macintosh and long boots. So these are the 5 aspects of facility preparedness. And the infection control practices are the last part which has been adequately covered previously also. Now coming to the personal aspect is division of teams. Why this is important is that we don't want all of our people to get exposed together. So what we did in our system is we had a different team for screening, for the suspect area, for the non-COVID area, for the COVID area, for the teleconsultation and OPD. If we divide our teams in this manner, the people know where they have to go every day, what is their duties, and in case of exposure, the number of people going into quarantine is less. Now, coming to the second aspect, which is the antenatal care. The first and the foremost question, is the course of COVID infection in pregnancy altered? Earlier reports showed no increased risk. However, the recent report showed that there is some amount of increased risk in terms of hospitalization, ICU admission and ventilation. However, the number of deaths have remained the same. Now, does the COVID infection affect the fetus? As Dr. Ankit has already mentioned, there is no increased vertical transmission, intrauterine infection, congenital malformation. So, COVID is definitely not an indication for MVP. But what has been shown is that there is increased rate of preterm births and cesarean section, and some adverse pregnancy outcomes have been shown to increase, like preeclampsia and some abortions. How do we deliver an optimal antenatal care when you don't want patients to come over? Decrease the number of visits from 8 to 4. Schedule the visits at 12, 20, 28 and 36 weeks, and we call this do the 4. When you do the antenatal care, reduce, postpone, increase the interval between visits, shorten the duration of visits, limit visitors. If the patient is high risk, we still need to individualize. Like ma'am said, we cannot not see the high risk patients. They still have to come and integrate telemedicine to optimize care. Now, I am pregnant. How can I protect myself? These 4 points still have to be done by all pregnant women. Wash hands, avoid touching face, social distancing and respiratory hygiene. If these 4 principles are followed, pregnant women are as much protected as anybody else.
How to triage a woman who's coming to a healthcare facility? Maintain a distance of 1 meter, follow droplet precaution, give the woman and attendant her mask if she's not already wearing, and fill the questionnaire. If we think that she's screened positive, place the patient in a designated COVID area, adhere to the standard precautions and testing as per criteria. Then we assess 3 things in a COVID positive pregnant woman. Does she have symptoms of COVID? Does she have comorbidities? And is she in labor? If all of these things are negative, then we can send the patient home for isolation for 2 weeks and reschedule her visit. Do a ultrasound for fetal growth after 2 weeks. So in mild disease, no other high risk, we can send the patient home. If, however, the patient is moderate to severe high risk or she has comorbidity, she needs to be admitted. While in admission, the mother needs to be monitored with vitals, and multidisciplinary management is required for the mother. Drugs in pregnancy, few trials have been there. Remdesivir, lopinavir, ritonavir have been used under a compassionate use protocol, but not much of evidence is available. If, however, mother turns out to be severe, which is various tools are available and requires ICU admission, then various tools are available which would decide whether she needs to have an ICU admission. And if the mother is in septic shock or acute organ failure, that would be a criteria to deliver the mother. Coming to the third part, which is labor and delivery, the triage in labor and delivery remains the same. But the important aspect is that COVID does not change the management of normal labor. However, person-to-person contact should be limited. Time in labor should be limited. For cervical lengthening, we can use misoprostol. Again, the mode of delivery is not changed. There is no evidence to favor one modality over the other. Cesarean should only be done when medically justified or by usual obstetric practice. Can we plan an induction for her? It is individual assessment for urgency of induction. If it cannot be delayed, then follow general advice for COVID-19. Now, if the lady had COVID-19 in early pregnancy, there is usually no alteration in time of delivery. If she has recovered from the infection in the third trimester, it is reasonable to postpone till the end of isolation. The maternal monitoring in labor remains the same, except that we need to keep monitoring for oxygen saturation and titrate the therapy accordingly. Again, assess for severity and the need for ICU admission. The delivery is urgent and required only if it needs assistance for maternal resuscitation. Otherwise, the mode of delivery does not change. Fetal monitoring is continuous electronic fetal monitoring. Labor analgesia is regional, is preferred unless it is required for respiratory compromise. Delayed cord clamping and skin-to-skin contact is recommended after adequate counseling and if the baby is doing well. So, to summarize, the management of pregnant women and for prevention is the same as non-pregnant women for avoiding exposure to the severe acute respiratory syndrome. The triage is based on symptom severity and obstetric emergencies. Management of labor is not altered in women giving birth during the COVID-19 pandemic or in women with confirmed or suspected COVID-19. COVID-19 is not an indication to alter the route of delivery. And multidisciplinary approach to management of suspected or confirmed cases can actually lead to an optimal maternal and fetal outcome. Thank you so much.
Dr. Puri, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Yes.
So the question was,
I lost contact.
The question was, is preeclampsia a COVID complication? There's one question which has been asked by on WhatsApp. What is your comment on that?
Yeah, basically preeclampsia is not a COVID complication, but COVID-19 disease and preeclampsia have a similar presentation, and that is where the confusion arises. So what I personally feel is, because both of these conditions have a similar pathophysiology in the sense that both are prothrombotic conditions and both have endothelial dysfunction, so one tends to mix it up. But definitely COVID does not cause preeclampsia.
Right.
It causes a preeclampsia like picture.
So this is not a complication of COVID per se.
Yes.
Right. Thank you very much. I'll ask one question to Dr. Sunesh now. What antibiotics preference are we giving in COVID-19 patients who have a lower latent severe infection?
In our specialty for Cygnus patient, cephalosporins remain first choice. We also tend to use combination of Clomax. So in our hospital, patients who undergo cesarean section, we tend to use same antibiotics. Only patients who are seriously ill, who have respiratory complication, that we tend to choose higher antibiotics.
Thank you very much. So I think that clarifies the picture. Dr. Mirza, I have one question for you, which is basically that for one of the on the WhatsApp, should thrombocarbolipin be given to all women postpartum who are COVID positive?
No, I don't think we are following any recommendation like that to give them a routine thromboprophylaxis. But if someone is at a particularly high risk, then only we can consider it.
So it's not something as a routine practice?
No. And there's been no reason to think we should do that.
Okay. Thank you very much. I have two questions to Dr. Praveen Kumar. And this is, there are two questions. One is, how many patients have you seen with severe COVID who have severe COVID disease and this has led to neonatal mortality? And secondly, should all neonates who are COVID positive be tested for inflammatory markers, and if so, how frequently?
In PGI, we have had around, I think, 15 odd deliveries to COVID positive women. And interestingly, two of them turned out to be positive. And the first case actually was a vertical transmission, because this baby was a preterm baby and this mother had very high viral loads. She was positive in the amniotic fluid. Her vaginal secretion were positive. The baby first sample as well as subsequent repeated samples were positive. And this baby required to be ventilated. So initially we thought maybe it's a hyaline membrane disease. We gave surfactant, treated. But the respiratory problem continued to persist, and by day 5, we had ruled out other infections, etc. Then finally, we concluded maybe it's a COVID-related lung disease. And this baby was given methylpred, IVIG, etc. And we had high cytokines reported and ferritin levels also. This baby couldn't survive, unfortunately. But most of the other babies have been kind of asymptomatic or with mild symptoms.
Okay, thank you very much. It could be associated sepsis also, which could have led to a higher cytokine. But I think that is always difficult to differentiate in such a situation. A few generic questions to Dr. Neena Raina, who's been involved from the CRO office of WHO as far as maternal, newborn and child health is concerned. That what are the challenges that you're seeing now as far as pregnancy and antenatal care is concerned in this region with the COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown, and how is it affecting maternal health, especially in rural part of the country?
Thank you very much, Dr. Guleria. Very pleased to see you, and thank you for inviting me to this national combined grand rounds. I see on your left and on your right, two people who are sitting are the heads of our WHO collaborating center. So I'm very, very pleased. It's such a good moment for us, for all of us. These are testing times, especially for the health sector, and we see that the whole of society approach and the whole of government approach has benefited our response to COVID-19. What has WHO done at the regional level? Especially, we found that at the headquarter level, for disruption of services, especially particularly for the most vulnerable populations, which is maternal, newborn, child, adolescent health, and older adults, which is aging, was not specific. So with WHO, UNICEF, NFPA, regional offices, and country offices, we developed some guidelines. We did the mapping of disruption in services for women, children, adolescents and newborns, and violence against women included, especially for March and April, because that was the time when the lockdown in many countries was happening. And different countries have reported different levels of disruptions. But then certainly, I would say that disruption has been there across all countries of our region. But the severity of disruption is varying. So India, for example, then we had these mapping results shared with our countries, member countries, ministries of health. We had a very good, we asked countries, how are you responding to address these disruptions? Because there are, as you said, Dr. Galeria, that there are demand side factors and there are provision side factors. And demand is, of course, the fear to go to the hospital. And provision side is, of course, health workers have been repurposed in many situations. All the member countries of our region made the presentations where every Ministry of Health person participated to learn what strategic approaches have been adopted to address this disruption. Because our idea is that the gains which have been made during the MDG era by reducing mortality, increasing coverages, should not be lost. I'm very happy to say that India has done wonderful work. Their guidelines on addressing disruption was released on 13th April. ICMR also released wonderful guidelines. So, we are supporting this 20 hospitals in India to really look into this pregnancy, COVID in pregnancy and neonate, and WHO Collaborating Center, Dr. Ashok Dairari and Dr. Sunesh are leading it. We also have started IAP. We are supporting IAP, Indian Academy of Pediatrics for COVID in children. And there are, of course, challenges. But then the issue is that there are innovative approaches countries are adopting to really address a disruption. For example, ASHA is going from home to home to provide tetanus toxoid or along with the ANM and iron folic acid tablets, teleconsultations. I saw there was one issue that prednisolone in one of that pregnant women, the case was presented, was discontinued. And I see that there are reports that the most of the pharmacies or chemist shops are not giving azithromycin, prednisolone, dexamethasone, or any other medicine which is given in COVID cases without the proper prescription. So there are lot of disruptions because of the new state level rules and conditions being applied, which can really lead to disruption in these services and coverages. So I think as WHO, we are supporting countries. We are in the process of documenting some of the best practices and innovative approaches to address these disruptions. Thank you very much. Over to you, Dr. Galeria.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Neena Rana, for giving a very comprehensive overview of the action that WHO is taking in this region. So I'll move on to two questions which are there for Dr. Manju Puri regarding COVID-19. And one of them is from one of the obstetricians that if a woman is COVID positive at 40 weeks of gestation, then do we need to postpone termination for 14 more days? What would you say as far as that is concerned? And why do you want, would that increase the risk of why COVID increases the risk of preterm birth? If it does actually. So, Dr. Puri, your response to these two questions? You have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Dr. Guleria, for the question. And for the first question, that is whether at 40 weeks we need to terminate pregnancy or not in a COVID positive person. So I think the guidelines say that we can wait up till 41 weeks. So if we do a monitoring of the patient as far as, the fetal surveillance is concerned and it is a low risk pregnancy, then one can do a non-stress test and do a amniotic fluid index and wait. And moreover, in case the patient is not symptomatic, then of course, if it is indicated that we have to go ahead with the termination of pregnancy, we should go. So basically, if it is indicated, no intervention needs to be stopped. And in case it is not indicated, then one can, of course, wait. So that is my answer to the first question. And the second is as regards the prematurity. Now, COVID has been associated with prematurity, but mainly it has been iatrogenic. That as soon as the patient becomes COVID positive, so the physician or the obstetrician or the team is worried that the patient may not have a cytokine storm and may not worsen. So they try and bring out the baby. So I think that is what is contributing more to the prematurity. And also to cesarean section, because they would do a cesarean section in these kind of scenarios. So I think these are the two things which are contributing, but definitely prematurity is increased. Any patient who's got fever or who's got a systemic illness will be predisposed to prematurity. But let's understand that majority of our patients are asymptomatic. It's been really, really, we've been lucky that the patients who are pregnant do not have any critical or severe illness. They are usually pre-symptomatic or they are mildly symptomatic.
Delivery and should all COVID positive mothers have a severe infection?
No, I think this is now very clear from a lot of data that is there, not only from what we had previously from literature and now we have from our own country, that there is absolutely no reason to believe that any one type of delivery is better. So it is strictly based on the obstetric indication as before. And in fact, I was just thinking in relation to what Dr. Manjupuri was saying also, that because our pregnant ladies, they come in an age group where they are younger and of course the female bias, and maybe that is one reason why we have been quite lucky that majority of the mothers do well and don't really have too much problem.
Thank you very much. One more question to Dr. Asna Sharma. This is about a pregnant woman, 23rd week of pregnancy, has mild symptoms, is COVID positive. What treatment would you advise such a lady who's 23 weeks pregnant and COVID positive?
So, as we discussed just now, sir, we have to see three things. First of all, the symptoms of COVID. Other thing that I would like to see is whether she has any other comorbidities as regards the pregnancy. And if there are no other comorbidities and she only has mild symptoms, then there is nothing that really needs to be done. And the patients would be just under observation in a COVID facility or even at home. And she just needs to monitor her vitals and the oxygen saturation. So currently for mild disease, there is no drug therapy, pharmacotherapy, which is recommended even in pregnancy.
I'll just sort of add on to that question, Dr. Parna, because that is what has been asked. Would you give doxycycline, azithromycin in such a situation?
So currently, as we have seen, we are not giving. Sir, I think I would ask, request you to answer this question for us, sir.
So I think the guidelines are not clear on that. It has to be on an individual basis. The issue would be, is it safe to give these drugs if someone, if an obstetrician thinks that he or she wants to give it, or a clinician wants to give it? So do you think it could be safely given?
Sir, as far as second trimester of pregnancy is concerned, sir, these drugs are safe. Like for as far as HCQ is considered concerned, so there is a lot of experience of HCQ with other disorders in pregnancy. So we are quite comfortable giving HCQ if indicated in pregnancy. So that is how we stand as regards drugs in pregnancy.
And then maybe you can just complete the story. What about steroids in pregnancy? Because there has been a lot of concern that steroids may lead to a flare-up of the underlying viral infection.
Right.
And therefore, some people are reluctant to give steroids, and sometimes they are indicated because of the maturity for the...
Right. So, sir, as far as the current evidence is concerned, so it is very strongly felt that unless the disease is severe, we should give steroids. So, there has been a lot of controversy around it that let's not change the management of pregnancy, whether it is steroids or whether it is magnesium sulfate for neuroprotection, unless the patient is critically ill or it is a severe infection. So, for all other cases, it has not really been seen to the see that, you know, it really worsens the illness. So, as far as we are concerned, we are very clear that for all kinds of mild, moderate, asymptomatic mild, moderate cases, we continue to give steroids for fetal maturity.
Right. So, they can be given if it is needed. I have one question for Dr. Ankit, and this is basically from one of the dietitians. How frequently do you see post-COVID sequelae in neonates and young infants, and what are the types of sequelae that you tend to see?
So we don't see it commonly, sir. So we have not seen a single case with a neonate at our own centers.
Okay, so this is nothing which is not commonly seen.
Yes.
Sometimes in the older age group, you can have the multi-system inflammatory syndrome that can happen. Dr. Yeah. Yari, so, would like to add to that.
So I think, sir, if we look at multi-system inflammatory syndrome, if you look at the global literature also, most of them occur after the age of 5 years, sir. In newborn babies, I think many of the pediatricians start suspecting MIS and do a lot of investigation. I would say all the investigations which happen in newborn sepsis may be there in a patient who has just like MIS. So like patient may have D-dimer due to DIC which may be setting in, cytokines may be higher, IL-6 may be high. Your CRP may be positive. Only thing which can make a distinction is viral between bacterial is procalcitonin level. Procal will be not raised so much in viral infection as compared to bacterial infection. So that is the point which will make a distinction. But I would say most of the newborn babies will have sepsis with multi-organ failure. They die due to that morbidity rather than COVID killing those newborn babies. COVID as such in newborn and infants and children is most of the time asymptomatic or only mild. Moderate to severe disease is very, very rare, sir.
Yes, I tend to agree with that because there's been another question asking for lung sequelae that can occur in neonates and younger children. I don't think that usually tends to happen.
So I think if you are doing ventilation on a baby and baby's lung gets damaged, you will have chronic lung disease, which we already see in babies who are VLBW or ELBW and which we are doing ventilation. So I would not say it is due to COVID, but it is an effect of the lung barotrauma which has occurred in the baby with ventilation.
So this is another question which I have for Dr. Praveen Kumar. And there are actually two questions which are pretty similar. One is that a neonate born at 30 weeks delivered to a COVID positive mother, when to shift to NICU if the neonate is uninfected or is infected on day one, what is your policy? And a similar question by another a doctor is that if the baby born to COVID positive mother at birth is tested negative, can the baby be admitted in routine neonatal unit? because apparently in their hospital this is not being allowed. So what is your policy and what would you advise them?
So what we do, that in case the baby is born to a COVID positive and it's symptomatic, we keep the baby in the special NICU. And only once the day 5 test is negative, we would shift them to the normal NICU. So till day 5, we will not move them to the normal NICU if they require NICU care.
Okay, so you have, and I think that is also as per the guidelines which have been mentioned.
Sir, can I mention?
Yeah,
so please. I think there is a wonderful app on mobile phone which National Neonatal Forum of India has made. It has COVID guidelines which are made by Indian Academy of Pediatrics, FOCSI and National Neonatal Forum of India. It gives a beautiful diagrams of patient flow for babies who are below 34 weeks of gestational age, above 34 weeks, while the baby is suspect or a positive baby, how you have to care for. So I would say, look at that diagram. It is on app on mobile phone and it is made by National Neonatal Forum of India. It gives all the flow for the patient, ideal flow.
Thank you. There's another question regarding a case that an individual has seen, and I'll ask Dr. Sunesh for that. This doctor says that the mother turned positive second day after delivery. What is the policy in terms of when this patient can be now discharged? Because the neonate is negative and the mother is otherwise fit to be discharged.
I thank you, sir. We had had similar cases where initially at delivery there was no positivity of the test, but in the postnatal period, mother started running fever and tested positive. So usually we shift them to same COVID facility, dedicated facility which we have at AIMS. Babies stay with the mother and usually they stay for a period of about 5 days or 6 days if they are asymptomatic, and then they can be sent home with the baby with advice that how to observe quarantine, how to take care of the baby. And repeat test is even not indicated if she is remaining asymptomatic. However, if she is symptomatic, she needs to be in hospital. She remains in the COVID dedicated facility, and only when she has recovered, she is asymptomatic, then we discharge the mother. Thanks, sir.
Thank you very much. Dr. Manju Puri, two questions for you. One is, what is the impact of fetus if mother is positive in the first trimester, and is there any indication for termination? And secondly, how safe is remdesivir during the same period in case a pregnant woman is COVID positive?
So as far as the first question is concerned, I think Aparna has given a very clear message that there is no indication for MTP if a patient is turned positive. Because data shows that there is no adverse effect of COVID infection on the in the first trimester on the fetus. That is part one. And part two is, as far as the drug is concerned, we have limited data which is available. So it has to be given only when it is indicated, when we feel that the benefits are more than the risks involved. And it has to be used only sparingly. And in case it is indicated in the mother, it has to be given.
Well, in her presentation also, as far as the indication was concerned, there are two questions. One of them has actually been addressed to Dr. Praveen Kumar, and it says to him, if neonates are positive for COVID, what is the incidence of need of intensive care? Maybe he can also answer, and I'll ask Dr. Durari also, how frequently have they had neonates who are positive requiring intensive care treatment? So we'll start with Dr. Praveen Kumar for his experience.
I think the need for intensive care actually depends on the gestation of the baby otherwise. Most of the babies will have symptoms related to prematurity or other perinatal problems, and not due to COVID. So if you are a high-risk center where all cases, high-risk pregnancies are being delivered, naturally you will have a lot of preterms, a lot of need for intensive care. But if you are a normal center with normal pregnancies, the need for intensive care is going to be very, very rare. So it is gestation dependent and not really dependent on the COVID.
Okay. Any experience from
same with us, sir. The first obstetric case which they presented, it was 33 weeks. That baby required like level 2 type of care. That baby had to be fed orogastric tube feeding and gradually weaned off to KS feeding, and temperature had to be, but the baby luckily did not have respiratory distress requiring ventilation. So it was managed with like level 2 type of care in the trauma center, which is our COVID hospital.
Thank you very much. Dr. Sunesh, one question for you. Are all antenatal women to be tested even if on screening they are considered to be low risk? And what is our policy as far as AIMS is concerned, and what do you think, what is at a national level?
When the pandemic started, facilities for testing were limited and we were testing only symptomatic patients. But as you know, in labor, any women may require a cesarean section. And what it all depends upon policy of your anesthesia colleagues. In my place, anesthetist insists that a woman who is undergoing cesarean section preferably have a test done within last 48 hours. So of late, as testing facility has become better with us, we are testing all women in labor. And if she is for a planned cesarean, we like to do test a day before she is planned for a cesarean section. So it will all depend what kind of facilities you have in your place. Thank you.
Yes, sir, and as sir has said it very well, and but also we must not forget the guideline that we cannot refuse to care for a patient because the test is not available. So while we recognize this need to do the test as far as possible and generate the holding areas and keep them waiting and all of that, but if your facility does not allow it, we cannot turn any patient away from this.
So I think that's a very important point. Ideally, one would like to test before delivery. But one must remember that if you're looking at India as a whole, especially rural India and areas where testing is not that frequently available or sometimes it takes a few days, you can't refuse care during labor just because you're waiting for the result to come. And you must take all precautions that are required in terms of protecting healthcare workers. But you cannot deny the care that is required as far as labor is concerned. And I think that is very important because this has happened in certain areas where the pregnant women in labor was sent away because the COVID result had not come. So I think I just wanted to bring that out.
Sir, can I just add to that also? As sir said, that there was a time when the tests were not so many available and we were continuing the services. And of course, at that time, the numbers were also not as many. But we did develop what we called our system of universal prevention. And that, I think, is something which everyone should follow. And what we told everybody, all the doctors, was we installed a shower system in our labor room. And we said, after every delivery, please go and wash your face, arms and legs. Change the clothes that you were wearing at the time. Make sure you wear your mask and shield at all times. And the entire labor room to be cleaned with the bleach, just as it would be if we thought there was. And with that simple profile access set in, I think it helped us because there were unsuspected entries to the labor room. But none of our residents turned positive or had a problem with that.
Thank you very much. So there's one question which I'll ask Dr. Aparna. Is COVID positive an indication for admission in a pregnant woman in advance? So we have a pregnant woman who is still on your follow-up, turns out to be COVID positive, but is asymptomatic. Is it an indication for being admitted, or can they be home isolated?
So, thank you, sir. So, as we discussed, there has to be three indications for admission. Either the mother is symptomatic COVID positive, or she has COVID positivity with significant comorbidities, which really we think that can complicate her pregnancy, or she requires admission for the purpose of some labor delivery issue. If either of the three things are not there, then the mother can very well be managed with home isolation.
So home isolation is something that can still be continued.
Yes.
But
so
close monitoring is required.
It's very much required.
As far as pregnancy
yes. So
is
within home isolation, when we send the mother for home isolation, we have to keep telling them three things: that one, mother, monitoring of the mother; second is monitoring of the baby with good fetal movement monitoring; and third is availability of transport and support at home at all times, so that they can are in reach for a health facility. So I think if we are able to counsel and talk to them at all of these times, then home isolation is a good option.
Thank you very much. There is another question which is basically both to obstetrician and neonatologist from a pediatrician in Bellary, Karnataka. And he says, second course of dexamethasone is not advised for prevention of RDS in view of long-term neurodevelopmental problem in the baby born. So which steroid is preferred? Dexamethasone, which can easily cross into the fetus, or methylprednisolone, which does not readily cross the placental barrier in pregnant women with COVID pneumonia and hypoxia? Dr. Sunesh.
So the dexamethasone remains the steroid of choice. It easily crosses, and usually we have to give four doses, small doses, and they do not significantly increase risk of complication. So we continue to follow this practice of giving dexamethasone four doses, 12 hours apart.
So I think that is a protocol that needs to be followed. Anything from the neurology point
so
of view?
So I think, yeah, dexamethasone is the drug of choice. Even if the mother is preterm and she has got COVID infection, you are giving steroid, again dexa will be the drug of choice.
So one question which I think is something which is for the future, I don't think we have a definite answer, it depends on the result. Are pregnant women eligible for vaccination? So you will need to get the data to show that they are safe before one says that they are, they could also be in the category for vaccination once they have a COVID vaccine. I think it's difficult to say that right now. One question which I can ask for Dr. Praveen Kumar, which is breastfeeding by COVID positive mother, how high is the risk as far as the neonate is concerned? Although this was covered, but maybe you can just re-emphasize that, because I think it's important for everyone to have that as a take-home message as far as breastfeeding for a new for a COVID positive mother is concerned. So Dr. Praveen Kumar.
I think the advantages of breastfeeding are very good. Benefit from mortality and quantity of the drug. And we have also shown that the corona virus 2 has not been very common in the country. On the other hand, there are many more variants. So, overall, there will be nothing other than the directly benefit of the drug. In our performance, we have to use the directly benefit and the drug. So, the recommendation is to use the
directly benefit if required. It's pretty safe.
WHO also says the same. Ki the mother has to take precaution for with the mask she has to wear, she has to do hand hygiene, and she can do breastfeeding to the baby. The risk is not there. So World Health Organization also recommends in the guidelines.
So I'll just repeat this, that it is safe with proper precaution, because this is another question which a doctor has sent in. And she says, I turned positive post-delivery fourth day. Can I breastfeed the baby? It was a term and normal delivery for from which day am I post-infectious? So, despite the fact that you turn positive on the fourth day, you can easily breastfeed taking proper precautions, including wearing a mask and hand washing. So, I think that's a very important message that we need to really put out there, because I can see that even doctors are a little bit reluctant. And another doctor said this, that I'm 33-year-old, I've had COVID infection at 5th week of pregnancy. Is it safe to continue my pregnancy? We've already answered that. Dr. Sunesh, maybe you can just re-emphasize that. Because she continues to say that I have continued to have loss of taste and smell even right now.
Whatever data we have with us, even if infection has occurred in early pregnancy, there is no substantial risk of any problem in the fetus. Normally, any pregnant woman will undergo a ultrasound NTNB scan, dual marker testing at 11 to 13 weeks, and a repeat detailed ultrasound at 18 to 20 weeks. So that should be done. And there doesn't seem to be any risk, and need not worry unnecessarily. And just a routine antenatal care is what is needed.
Thank you. So this is a generic question, which I think can ask Dr. Neerja also to answer that. After how many days that the lady is RT-PCR positive, can she be delivered in a non-COVID labor room? So she is RT-PCR positive, and now after how many days will you say it's safe for her to come back and deliver in a non-COVID labor room?
I think that same rule applies, that we wait for 2 weeks, especially if they are asymptomatic, 2 weeks. If they have been symptomatic, we wait for at least 10 days after the symptoms have subsided, and we are reasonably sure then that they have cleared. But I do think that once we admit her, we will once again do her test before we admit her to the non-COVID, just as we described for the neonate who was being transferred. So once she comes in, she will be like a fresh admission and she will go through the test.
So I think there are just two caveats that I'd like to put up. One, of course, is that healthcare workers would want that the pregnant lady is tested again to make sure that she is COVID negative. However, you must remember that people who, after about 10 to 14 days, if you are asymptomatic, your RT-PCR may still be positive, but it may be viral shedding, which is dead viruses, and you are not infectious. So if you have a situation like this, it's better to be safe, but at the same time, not again deny the delivery to the women, because after about 10 days, the chance of infectiousness comes very, very low, but your RT-PCR may still be positive because you may still continue to shed non-viable virus particles, which will be picked up by the RT-PCR. So that is something that we need to keep in mind. One question which is there for Dr. Manju Puri: can COVID be a risk for infertility in the future? This is a concern which one person has. So what is your comment as far as this is concerned?
Apparently, no. I don't think so. It is going to cause infertility. We are more worried that it might lead on to more births now with that lockdown period. So it's the other way around.
Okay. So I think that is something that one needs to keep in mind as far as COVID-19 is concerned.
Dr. Sunesh, is there any risk of the routine vaccination that is being done in patients who are COVID-19 positive, pregnant women who are COVID-19 positive? And that is also asked for as far as neonates are concerned. So we'll cover both parts.
Yes. In pregnancy, we tend to give 2 doses of tetanus toxoid 4 weeks apart. It is absolutely safe. We should not withhold for any fear. And there doesn't seem to be any report suggesting that it is harmful.
So, as Dr. Ankit showed, both the babies who were COVID positive, they got their vaccination on day one. And the routine vaccination schedule should not be disturbed, even if you have a COVID positive baby. The harm of not giving immunization to infants will be much more, because it has been reported by World Health Organization that following Ebola epidemic in Africa, while the routine immunizations were not happening, there were a lot of deaths which occurred due to measles infection and a lot of complications. Thousands of children died there. So I think routine immunization services have to be followed as they are advised, and these are essential services, and the routine schedule should be followed for vaccinations.
I agree with that. I think one of the biggest challenges that the lockdown and COVID-19 has had is that it has caused major disruption in non-COVID care, and one of them has been the routine immunization program. It has really suffered a lot because the whole system shut down, and a large number of children who were due for the immunization could not get immunized because of the fact that there were really no one available to start that or give the immunization. And we really need to get all of this back on track. Maybe Dr. Neena Raina can just throw some light on this, because I think this is something where we have had a huge problem as far as delivery of healthcare is concerned, preventive health is concerned. So what are your comments on this, Dr. Raina, if you can have some comments?
Sorry, in between I got disconnected, and I understand there was a question also related to breastfeeding, and I agree with Dr. Derari that breastfeeding and also skin-to-skin contact, especially so in low birth weight and premature babies, is something which should be continued, you know, by, you know, these mothers. COVID positivity is not a criteria to discontinue skin-to-skin or kangaroo mother care or breastfeeding. Now, this is something which is happening a lot in terms of now, as I said, provision side, I think the system is gearing up to give immunization, vaccination to under 5 children. They are also ready to treat pneumonias and diarrheas. But then demand side factors are playing a big role, especially in situations where there is a lot of fear. If the hospitals have both COVID and non-COVID you know, services being provided, people are really scared. So one side is this, that people are scared of going. And you know, there are the things which need to be done is to really educate communities and make sure that the correct information reaches out to people, also promoting self-care and encouraging mothers to take their babies, especially I see in India, it's very surprising that the data which I was hearing and I was getting from you know, some of the colleagues is clearly said the institutional deliveries, especially in the public sector, has not declined. So I would say thanks to all the COVID warriors who have been providing this care at the institution level and encouraging women to come and deliver and not really turning them out if their COVID positivity, you know, COVID test is not known. So I would still say that we have to make sure that some of the task sharing is done. We have to make sure that the health workforce is there, because a lot of health workforce has been repurposed for COVID. Then we have to do a bit of a task shifting and task sharing, and let the others take on some of the responsibilities. For example, in some states, ASHAs went home to home to give iron folic acid tablets and ORS packets to make sure that these, and even contraceptive pills, to make sure that women don't have to come out. So the A&Ms were giving it to them to go and deliver in the houses of people, irrespective whether problem is there or not, or creating some depot holders. So I would say that we have to work through the media. We have to work properly, in the sense that we have to encourage people to go for vaccination. We have to find alternate ways where, with the proper IPC distance and mask and hand washing, if in any case vaccination was delivered during the vaccination days, if we can have these teams really gear up to go and immunize these children. Vaccination is extremely important. Second is that all pneumonias in children are not COVID related pneumonia. And the pneumonia, I know, we all understand pneumonia and diarrhea kill. So today we had, we have series of webinars across life course. So today we had a webinar on adolescent health. And it was very interesting. We were talking of opening of schools, where government also has Sri Lanka, case study was presented. WHO guidelines, UNICEF guidelines are there. So there are guidelines, there is guidance available. But then we have to see how every country responds to it. But immunization, I completely agree, especially all those who are connected today here. I would say when women deliver, make sure that you counsel them to go for immunization, vaccination. And at the same time, we have to really see how do we advertise and let people, communities know where the vaccination is now available. Earlier, they are used to A&Ms coming to their villages and delivering. So I would say that, yes, India is doing very well in this regard. Ministry of Health, has been providing guidance, resources, and some innovative approaches have been used to really deliver services. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. One final question I have for Dr. Manju Puri. After that, I'll ask all of the panelists to give their final comments or take-home messages. This is a question which has just come in, which is basically a COVID-positive mother, 30 weeks gestation, moderate symptomatic with cough, mild desaturation, responded to treatment. She was given steroids also for 3 weeks and low molecular heparin. The question is, how long should we continue low molecular heparin post-COVID in pregnancy? So how long do you give low molecular heparin in such patients once they have recovered? So, Dr. Praveen Kumar, your comments on this. Sorry, Dr. Manju Puri.
Basically, you know, we do not have too much of experience in treating symptomatic COVID patients. As far as, you know, how long should it be given? So maybe, Dr. Guleria, you may be in a better position to give this answer.
You know, what we would do normally in these patients is that we do a risk-benefit analysis. As a routine, we do not give low molecular heparin or even the oral anticoagulants, because we can use that also in normal individuals. Subsequently, once they have recovered from moderate to severe COVID-19 infection. But in some places, they will do a risk assessment. If you have a person who is moribund, obese, has a high risk of thromboembolic complication, then oral anticoagulants are sometimes continued for 4 to 6 weeks. So I don't think in the case that has been asked for, there is any indication for continuing low molecular heparin post-COVID, even in pregnancy. I would ask if Dr. Sinesh to agree with that.
Yes, sir. I think we fully agree. Only if during the symptomatic phase she gets a treatment and then no need to give in the continuation.
Okay, thank you very much. We have actually run out of time. So just final comments, and I'll start with the faculty on Skype. So Dr. Praveen Kumar, your final comments and take home messages as far as neonates are concerned in during this era of COVID-19.
I think basically, as everybody has said and data shows, most of the newborns do very well. They remain asymptomatic and prognosis is very good. So we must continue the standard care, which means rooming in, breastfeeding, routine immunization, you know, all that must continue. Kangaroo mother care for low birth weight, that must continue.
A word of caution,
which is applicable to all, not only newborn.
Actually, what we are now seeing that the COVID, so-called COVID area of the hospital are safer than the non-COVID area.
And the reason is that the non-COVID area of the hospital, people forget to take, whether it's using the appropriate mask, the face shield, or the hand hygiene. So I think it is irrespective of universal precaution, even non-COVID area.
I think that's a very, very important point. We're also observing that we're having more outbreaks in cases in non-COVID area than in the COVID area. It's an important point. Your final comments, Dr. Manju Puri from LHMC. take home message is concerned.
Opportunity to me, you know, to be part of this national combined grand rounds on COVID-19 is a wonderful initiative. As WHO, we would always be there to support ministries of health and also through our WHO collaborating centers, we are trying to make sure that the hospitals across the country, you know, get benefit. I see that this is an opportunity, and this is a pandemic which has come after 100 years. And as our regional director, Dr. Poonam Khetrapal Singh, also said, this is the time we must document. And I think whatever we are doing, if we don't document it properly, we don't know when the next pandemic is coming. And it will be very important that we document our experiences, whether they are related to delivery of services or they are related to the hospital care. And as WHO, we'll be very keen and very supportive to help clinicians as well as public health people, ministries of health, to document these experiences, what innovative approaches were used and what was done. I agree with Dr. Manju Puri, quality of care is extremely important, and this is an, you know, this is a situation which is also giving us, in addition to giving us challenges, giving us opportunities. So this is an opportunity when we can really focus also on quality of care, and not only the coverage but quality as well, which Dr. Ashok Derari has led in you know, in AIMS, and also is has spread it across many countries of our region, which is point of care quality improvement, which we call POCI. So I think with these words, I would like to say thank you very much. And as for immunization, I forgot to mention that there is a WHO, we have WHO field staff, which is really supporting, and the you know, these activities have again been initiated. District plans are being, again, micro planning is being done with the districts to enhance the immunization coverages, to make sure that whatever we have lost, the susceptible populations have increased. Whatever we have lost, we are able to gain now, you know, over a period of time with the lockdown gone and things, you know, getting under control a bit more. So India is doing wonders, and we are really helping. We are trying to see how we document some of the innovative approaches and the strategies which are being adopted in India, so that we can really share it with the other countries for better learning. Plus future, you know, God forbid, if there is any pandemic in future, there are enough documentation on the, you know, strategies which were adopted. We may or may not be there, but then I think for generation, this is very, very important that we document all the best practices which were adopted during this pandemic. Thank you very much, Dr. Galeri. Over to you.
Thank you very much, and for highlighting the importance of documentation, especially as we move ahead, because the challenges that we face and how we overcome them are actually lessons which could be useful even for subsequent outbreaks of pandemic. I'll now have quick comments from the panelists in the room, and I'll start with Dr. Ankit. Would you like to give a take-home message?
Yes, sir. So basically, I want to stress upon that the babies and the mother dyad who are at home, they should be practicing the infection preventive measures. Like, they should observe the medical mask and hand hygiene at the home. A regular follow-up of these babies, it should be done by a designated nurse from that of the NICU. And if a neonate is reported to be unwell at home during the home isolation, he should be taken to that of a designated COVID hospital for the assessment and further testing. And the mother, that is the most important part, she should practice the respiratory hygiene, and she should wear a mask at home and maintain a distancing with that of the baby. So these precautions must be taken care by that of the mother at home.
Thank you, Dr. Aparna Sharma, your comments.
So thank you, sir. I would like to just say one thing, that even in the times of pandemic, we should not forget about respectful maternity care. These are the times where we should avoid physical touch and not forget about the human touch. So I think that is one thing that I would like to reemphasize again and again, that the importance of communication with the patient and the relative, and to try and deliver care with respectful, with respect and dignity to the mother. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I think it's a difficult time for families, because it's a very happy time when babies come and the families want to crowd around and everybody wants to come and meet the baby and see the baby. So we have to be very careful that families as a whole will maintain social isolation when they have a pregnant mother or they have a newborn baby in the house.
Thank you.
Suddenly in the month of March, we were faced with a disease about which we have not hadn't heard and haven't read about it. But these last 5 months have taught us a lot, how working together, how being as caring as before this pandemic started, it can help patients and it can teach us for the future. So as mentioned by my previous speakers, we must not let our guards down, and that is very important. We are not very sure how long it is going to last. That is a question which is there in the mind of everybody. But till the last patient, we should continue to look after patients and not let our guards down. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So I think, sir, it is a high time that in the country, most of the people who are providing newborn and obstetric care, they need to get together. They need to collect the data, information, create evidence so that we are well informed what is happening, what the outcomes are, and then publish it also in literature so that it is going to be valuable for other people in the region, in the other countries also. And my take home message is, sir, number one, vertical transmission is very, very rare. It should be looked for only in a research mode by supporting research studies. And the second thing is, a newborn baby who is born to a COVID positive mother, once the mother is going home, baby must be tested at least once. It may be at the time of discharge on day 3 or day 5, because once the baby goes home, he, if the baby is positive, he is going to be like a risk to the elders in the family, because all family members are going to hold that baby. So at least one test should be done. As rightly you said, if test is positive also, we should not do a repeat test on the baby.
Thank you very much. So I'd like to start by really thanking everyone for coming on board as far as this grand round is concerned, especially the faculty from institute outside, PGI, WHO CRO, and from Lady Harding Medical College. As has already been said, pregnancy is an emotional and exciting time for the entire family, especially the mother. And therefore, during this time, sometimes when we have COVID-19, the fear of the unknown and the fear of what may happen to the mother and the newborn is something that sort of creeps into the family and disrupts their excitement and emotional moment. So I think more important is that we as clinicians should be able to reassure the family and the pregnant women that there is really no risk and this is not something which is a cause of concern. There is a need to really re-emphasize infection control measures for the whole family. And as has been shown by the cases presented, team effort becomes very, very important, and getting everyone on board really makes a big difference. There are a lot of lessons that one learns as we go along the pandemic, and I think we should document them, as has already been mentioned, see how we can improve and see how we can decrease the morbidity and mortality overall, including pregnancy and neonate. But I think more important is that we should not let the trust and the faith that patients have in physicians down. We should not let them down, and despite the fact that there is a lot of fear among healthcare workers, whether it be pregnant women, women in labor, or the neonate, we must really stand up to them and really look after them as we would have done in a non-COVID time. At the same time, be inquisitive, ask questions every time you see something different. COVID has given us that opportunity and to innovate and think outside the box. So I'd just like to thank you all for joining in for this national combined grand round on COVID-19. We'll see you next week with another topic, but I think this was a very exciting, interesting, and a very thought-provoking and some learning for all of us as far as managing pregnancy and neonate in this era of COVID-19 is concerned. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining in, and thank you to all the panelists, especially those who came in to Skype. Thank you very much.